Can I just start by asking you what it feels like to be in the second epicenter? If the United States is the worst off, Brazil is certainly second. What does it feel like as you hear the totals and the, you know, the caseload increasing daily?
It feels like being trapped in a nightmare because all of this could have been avoided. Brazil wasn't hit by the virus until it had hit already Italy, the United States. We had all the media pressuring the government to take measures, but Bolsonaro really resisted and has done the most absurd remarks. As for example, when questioned about the mounting deaths, he said, "I'm not a grave digger. So what? Everyone's destiny is to die." He has boycotted initiatives from mayors, governors that have tried to stop the pandemic. As you said, he didn't just change one, but two health ministers, and is putting us all in a state of paralysis as the deaths continue mounting. His indifference only grows.
Petra, we're watching this horrible video, of course, of the graves going into the coffins going into the ground. And we've seen in, for instance, the Amazon region, we've seen mass graves in Manaus, the capital there. I mean, obviously, the pictures are telling a very dramatic story. I wonder whether you've noticed any change in tone from Bolsonaro, your president, since he himself contracted the disease. He has COVID.
He announced that with a smirk on his face and used it as an opportunity to become a poster boy for chloroquine, taking it in a video and saying that it was working well for him and that he was fine, and using it really to downplay the seriousness of the virus. And it's also quite strange that months ago in March, he had gone to a trip to the United States and 20 people from his delegation became contaminated. And he refused to show his tests at the time. He only did so after the Supreme Court forced him to do so. And now he volunteered this information in a moment where he's involved in a huge corruption scandal and where that's in the media, and it seems like a perfect plot to divert attention.
And perhaps to get some sympathy, let me ask you, have his poll numbers suffered? He was elected in a landslide in 2018. Has his popularity sunk at all, or is he still very popular?
His popularity diminished even more after the pandemic and after these scandals, but it continues very solid at 30%.
So let me ask you, because look, when the pandemic sort of raised its head, and even before it came to Brazil, your then health minister and the government took some very early and quite, you know, severe moves. I mean, they banned cruises. The health minister was very careful about sort of a lockdown before there was a lockdown, so to speak. So what happened to that early success compared to what's happened now, which is a total disaster?
Well, Bolsonaro fired this health minister after he had said that quarantine was a good thing. And then when the second health minister refused to recommend chloroquine for COVID patients, he decided himself to quit, that second health minister. Bolsonaro then named an army general and decided to militarize the whole ministry, substituting health specialists by military people. And that has created a tension where a Supreme Court judge has recently said that Bolsonaro's actions and the fact that the military is still supporting him makes the military be collaborating with what he sees as a genocide. That remark is very serious and has created a lot of tension between the powers.
It's a very, very serious remark to talk about genocide in this situation. But of course, also the Supreme Court I wonder what I'm trying to ask you is this military general who's the interim health minister, the number of military, either retired or active duty, who have been brought into the government and into institutions, civilian institutions, by this president. You know, you did a documentary called The Edge of Democracy about your country. You probably couldn't have envisioned that when you did it, or the extent of the infiltration or the representation of the military in your government. Is there a fear beyond the pandemic that, you know, Brazil is tilting again into a sort of a potential undemocratic future?
Definitely. When I made the documentary, The Edge of Democracy, I already feared and felt that Brazil had done a very bad job in terms of its past. We never punished the military that were responsible for the crimes during the dictatorship. We were very weak in teaching and showing the population that this was a terrorist state. And that created the possibility of electing a military man who always praised the dictatorship. And since he is in power, we're already in a military rule under many regards. We have more military men in government now than we had during the military dictatorship in Brazil. There are more military men in Brazil in power today than there is in Venezuela. And the erosion of democracy and the destruction of democracy does not happen necessarily through a military coup as it did in the past, but through the weakening of the institutions as it is happening now. And what we see happening is that whenever Bolsonaro feels weakened or threatened, as he has recently with two investigations, one that is trying to investigate the possibility that he was elected with a fake news campaign, and the other that is involving his son and a corruption scandal. As the investigations push Bolsonaro against the wall, he uses the threat of a military coup to protect himself. He's doing that by going to rallies, asking for a military intervention, rallies against the Supreme Court and the Congress. And his son recently said that it's not more a matter of if a military intervention will happen, but when.
Well, I mean, that is extraordinary to hear that coming from a source so close to the president. But so let me ask you this, because, you know, he's been criticized for being, as you've sort of hinted, at protests where people are calling for the Congress and the Supreme Court to be abolished. But on the other hand, he has also responded to all of this. He's essentially said, I think he said a while back, Us military men from the armed forces, and I'm also a military man, hold the true responsibility for democracy in our country. We could never follow absurd orders. In other words, he's trying to play down the idea that any of the military types around him or even himself could issue, you know, non-civilian orders and the like. Mm-hmm. Have people, you know, Democrats in the country taken any sort of satisfaction, or do they feel slightly at ease since Bolsonaro himself said that there could never be, I mean, I guess he's saying there could never be a military takeover or a military coup or a return to a military dictatorship?
Well, the thing is that Bolsonaro's strategy of communication, similar or copying Trump, is always of saying a very absurd remark and then negating it. He's done that with absolutely everything. So it's people, I don't know, I don't think people have been more at ease, because not only him, but other generals close to him have used this threat of a military coup, saying that if investigations into Bolsonaro come too close to him, they will not think twice before using that resource. So no, I don't think that brings us any ease.
Of course, you know, Peru in the 90s, which is not so far away from you, the president there, also a right-wing populist, Alberto Fujimori, he did send tanks and troops to dissolve Congress and the judiciary. So clearly, you know, the fear of the militarization of government is a real one in Latin America, which emerged after decades and decades of that sort of situation. But I guess, you know, so Bolsonaro said that thing about, you know, there's no militarization of our government. But on the other hand, from 1999, there has been a clip of him that is making the rounds now. And let's just play it, because it's a very different Bolsonaro from the one who says there's no threat to our civilian democracy.
Não há a menor dúvida, daria golpe no mesmo dia. Não funciona. E tenho certeza que pelo menos 90% da população ia fazer festa e bater palma, que não funciona. Pra que o Congresso hoje em dia não serve pra nada, xará? Não deu logo um golpe, pô. Parte logo pra ditadura.
So that was in 1999, when he was deputy in Rio de Janeiro, federal deputy there. How is that being sort of received, that now viral video going around reminding people?
Well, what is uncanny is that was when we reached 30,000 deaths. Bolsonaro in some ways fulfilled his promise. And another remark that he did in a similar way, which had similarities to this one, was one when he was congressman in 2017, where he was trying to pass a law to make legal the use of a drug for cancer that, like chloroquine, has no scientific proof of its use. And he, when asked about the drug, he said, "If it heals or it doesn't heal, I don't know. I'm a military man. My specialty is to kill, not to heal." So it feels like he's using the same logic here.
You've been repeating statements that, you know, one is even more shocking than the next. I mean, coming from Bolsonaro's own mouth, coming from the mouth of his family, it's pretty sort of dramatic. And I think we do actually have to point it out, because we see that democracy is at threat in many parts of the world. And furthermore, that there's a rise of what people call illiberal democracy and claim illiberal democracy. So I think, you know, clearly the concern about the survivability of democracy is very, very important and relevant right now. But particularly I want to ask you, because it's relevant to you and your family. You come from, I think, tell me about your family, because you come from obviously a political side that's very against the right, and also your family had experience with the military dictatorships.
Mm-hmm. Yes, my family is divided. Half of my family supported the military coup in the 60s, while my parents fought against it and had many friends killed and tortured by the dictatorship. So this is very painful for them to see, after a whole lifetime where they felt they had brought or fought for a democracy to be established in Brazil, to see such a recession into the past. And puts them in a situation which is very disheartening. And what I think is important for people to know is that Bolsonaro's biggest strength is that he's Trump's ally. Even though Trump does not think twice before ridiculing Bolsonaro, that is Bolsonaro's strength. So the next election of the United States will be crucial in determining also Brazil's future.
So that's really interesting. Let me just give you a sort of a counterfactual question, because a lot has been written about whether he can politically survive the way he has dealt with the pandemic, as you've mentioned, ridiculing it and you know, watering down masks. I mean, you know, not to mention the 8 million people unemployed, the plummeting of the economy, the poor people in the favelas who cannot socially distance. I mean, all the issues that we're seeing, not to mention, of course, the continued ravaging of the Amazon, the rainforest there, all under cover of this situation. But some people are asking, and I wonder whether you can comment on this, that if he actually survives COVID himself and does survive it well and doesn't show any worse symptoms than he's showing right now, could that, in fact, you know, make him sort of the superhero of this moment and vindicate all that he said about this, particularly obviously to his supporters? But could he actually come out, you know, stronger? Because we know that in Brazil, pandemics and diseases have actually served to topple and damage previous democratically elected presidents.
It's hard to know. I feel the pandemic has hurt his popularity in the middle class. There was an irony where he was against giving aid initially, or wanted to give a very small aid, but the Congress pressured. And now a lot of the poorest in Brazil are receiving a 600 reais aid. And even though this was not thanks to him, his popularity has grown with this. So it has diminished amongst the middle class and has grown amongst the working class. But if he survives COVID well, I think still we will, it's very likely that Brazil will become number one in the world in terms of cases and deaths. And people will feel this in their own families, in their neighborhoods. And I think this will affect the way they see the government. But one thing that is disheartening is how the virus has really exposed Brazil's inequality with Black people being at much greater risk of contamination and deaths. Thousands of indigenous have been contaminated, and the deregulations that you mentioned in the Amazon have put them at greater risk with miners mm-hmm. contaminating indigenous populations. And he's done all of this supposedly because of the economy, and the economy is only worsening with foreign investors backing out because of deregulations in the Amazon. And so there's really not a perspective where I see him coming out as a hero.
It's really fascinating to watch. And as you mentioned, the minorities are suffering the most. And that is what we're seeing in the United States and elsewhere in this pandemic. Petro Costa, thank you very much for joining us tonight.